Alright, let's get into WWE Monday Night Raw for March 22nd, 2004.
Oh yeah.
The first draft lottery.
Oh yeah, that's right. Desperate times called for desperate measures here. WrestleMania 20 sucked. No, I'm kidding. At least that's what at least that's what the Observer would make you think.
Yeah, of course, I'm sure.
Well, it was Goldberg and Brock, too. So like Goldberg and Brock are gone, so they're doing anything to shake things up again. We gotta shake things up again for the fifth time.
All right, so we start with the cold open here.
Yes.
The Raw and SmackDown locker rooms are hanging out backstage as the draft lottery is live tonight.
This is awesome. They do the bumper at the top with the Eric Bischoff face at the end, which is iconic.
And they turn up the crowd noise, too. It goes,
yeah, that's awesome. I love this locker room split here, James. This is fucking awesome.
Yeah, the presentation here is really, really cool.
Everyone on the Raw side is wearing Raw shirts, and they're also all in their gear as well. So, like, Hurricane and Rosie are in the front wearing Raw shirts and their whole gimmick. Then we go to the SmackDown side. Everyone is not only in SmackDown shirts, but SmackDown hats.
they were branded out of their minds.
Kurt Angle's wearing his backwards. Rey and Ultimate Dragon are wearing them on top of their masks.
That was awesome.
It's fucking sick.
Bischoff and Heyman are backstage staring at each other. Heyman has a neck brace on because Undertaker tombstoned him on SmackDown last week. Vince McMahon walks up and he says, "Tonight is the first draft lottery." He has to explain the rules. For some reason.
Well, you do. I was confused when I heard draft lottery. I felt like, is this the first draft? No, we already watched the first draft.
Yes, it's the lottery.
What is a draft lottery?
We're gonna shake things up. And by God, we're going to do it. There's going to be how he describes it is very interesting. I don't think, maybe the word tumbler doesn't exist yet. There's going to be a bin of SmackDown stars.
Did he say bin?
Bin. And you get to choose Bischoff and Heyman. You get to choose from the Raw roster bin. And there will be 12 picks altogether. And you can trade anyone you wish, as long as you do so by 12 midnight tonight. The show ends at 11, so I don't know why they did that.
You know, go to WWF.com.
Yeah, the supplemental draft they used to do afterwards.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. You're right.
I also don't know. They didn't really trade anything.
Well, I think there is a trade, and that's why a big name ends up back on Raw.
There is a trade, but also, can you only trade people that were drafted, or can you trade other people? They didn't really go into that.
Oh, you know what? I think it's anyone, because I believe I'm jumping ahead, but I think the Dudleys get traded for Triple H.
The Dudleys get traded to TNA.
You're also correct.
Well, sorry about that.
Bischoff says my champions are exempt, right? And Vince said, "No way, Bucko." Heyman and Bischoff try to shake hands with Vince as he leaves, and he just fucking big leaves him.
He said, "Fuck off." Yeah, no one is exempt on either roster. Everyone is a part of that. No one. All of you are in the bin. You're in the bin.
I don't care if you're here or you're not. Randy Orton's throat is fucked up. Tonsillitis.
You are working.
Now take the drugs, the sex, the money, the generation of drugs. Let's get it on, sex.
Play that fucking music.
Is this like very early version of this? Because this intro video has a lot of clips that I don't recognize.
Yeah, I needed more Stacey Keibler.
One of them is just Maven doing a dropkick.
That's his move, baby. There
yeah,
he
I
is.
Just,
Maven.
I know that.
There he is.
That's what I think of, the dropkick.
And there's Maven doing a dropkick again.
Yeah. He's got that down. His finisher in the games wasn't even a dropkick. It was DDT.
That's crazy. It's a no way we are not making a dropkick a finish in this game.
We don't have the technology to make a shitty move like that a finisher. We can't do it. Sorry, bro.
So they have everybody here. JR, King, Taz, Cole, the whole commentary team. They have their own Raw and SmackDown name cards. Two pedestals, gold bins.
It's dude, there's a guy behind Cole and Taz with a small blinged out WWE title on a necklace. And he keeps showing it off. It's awesome.
This presentation is very tight. Like, everything is very well branded. Like, SmackDown has his very own unique thing. Raw is very unique.
Yeah.
The way that they present the guys. Very stark contrast. I know, like, obviously, SmackDown's blue, Raw's red, but full red shirts, full blue shirts. Like,
yeah,
it's kind of interesting to see.
Like,
the
yeah, SmackDown
here.
Guys come out to the SmackDown with the SmackDown like nameplate. These SmackDown commentators for their matches or whatever. Yeah, it's,
very
it's
cool.
Fucking cool. Yeah,
we have the draft lottery town hall.
Of course, Bischoff comes out to his, you know, ah, I'm back. And Heyman comes out to his infamous theme. Well, you let us know how it sounds, James.
So what the hell is this?
I don't know. Like, I feel like he does use that for a minute, but it's so unrecognizable.
What the fuck is going on, man? Oh,
he should have came out to the SmackDown theme. Okay.
Yeah, they, you're right.
So Heyman says he was assaulted by Undertaker on Sunday, Thursday night SmackDown.
This past Sunday, this past Thursday. Let me try that one more time.
I'm gonna let you try that one more time.
Paul Heyman keeps saying that this is Paul Heyman SmackDown, which
that is cool.
It's very. I know that. Like Paul Heyman's, that was not written down. Like,
I was gonna say they definitely didn't. Like Vince didn't say you have to call this Paul Heyman SmackDown. He probably hated that. Actually,
yeah, that's probably why he later said, you know what? Actually, you're drafted and you're fired and get out of here.
You go down to fucking Louisville. You get out of here.
He also started everything with, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Paul Heyman.
Some things never change, I guess.
Everything, yeah.
Yeah, you're right.
He also said he'll deal with Undertaker in his own personal way. Which eventually that means he's going to kill Paul Bearer.
He'll be back. Paul Heyman rolls the gotcha machine and he pulls his ball out. It is literally gotcha balls that you open up and it has paper in it.
It's like the Royal Rumble.
Yeah. And Heyman says,
so, yeah,
one of the premier groups on Raw. I was like, oh, damn. Okay. That's good. Evolution.
I was like,
or...
well, they're going to, yeah, because they zoom in on Evolution. So I was like, okay, it's not Evolution, but it's like, it's the first one. You know, you're going to like, you know, people, you want people to stay tuned in. Like, this is going to be rocking. Like, oh, I wonder who, like, who's going, like, who's a big tag team? Like, I don't know. Maybe. I don't even know. I had Evolution.
I was
probably
thinking NWO or something. NWO round at this time. I don't even know.
I think they're gone.
Thinking off the top of my head. Yeah, but I was like, maybe.
Now, the NWO this time was Chavo Guerrero. Super crazy.
It was just Xbox.
You're right.
You could, there's that whole Big Show. You know, the NWO is
yeah,
not
of
at this
course.
Point.
Shawn Michaels was around.
The NWO, Flair, Big Show, and Xbox.
What the hell?
The fuck?
Well, one of the premier groups on Raw is being broken up right now due to this ball.
Yes.
Dot, 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 dot.
And it is...
Rene Dupree is the first fucking draft. I could not believe this.
You can feel the air being sucked out of the venue.
Why didn't you start with like Chris Benoit or Triple H or something?
Anybody else? I mean, unless I thought Rene Dupree was cool, but like, what? Michael Cole says that's a great start for SmackDown.
He's trying to sabotage SmackDown. He said, I'm trying to go to Raw. I've had it with Taz.
So they show backstage Sylvain and Rob Conway look concerned. Everyone is, for some reason, looking offended that Rene Dupree is going to SmackDown, as if it was his choice, and if they gave a fuck that Rene Dupree was going to SmackDown.
Yeah. So Rene Dupree, I actually wrote down here, they have got to be fucking insane to do this thing first. They share like an ESPN breakdown of Rene Dupree's career.
Okay, I do like that they did those for everybody, though.
They are. I like this a lot. The presentation was very, very cool here. They obviously were taking time and trying to make this seem like it's, you know,
something.
Which is crazy because like they just, I don't know how many more of these they do, but eventually it goes away like forever until like they go to Fox or whatever.
Well, you know how the splits always go. They always just
give
up on them.
Yeah, you're right. He had his first match at the age of 14.
Yeah, he was only 20 years old here.
He probably faced Pogo the Clown.
Yeah, he probably faced fucking...
Abdullah the Butcher.
Dysfunction in a 20-man elimination bat tag.
He was young altar boy, too.
So... commentary then starts talking as Dupree comes out here. Dupree comes out, takes a picture with Paul Heyman on the stage. Very funny. I'm sure that picture is somewhere in the archives or something.
I feel like that camera didn't work, actually.
It's just flash. There's nothing.
Yeah. Gimmick camera.
Commentary as Dupree is the number one pick walking down the ramp. First guy you see, and commentary goes, You know how cool it would be if like a star was picked, like HBK or Benoit or RVD.
No, don't say that.
Dude, they immediately start. And whoa, what other superstars can come to SmackDown? Stone Cold?
No, they didn't. Future Rene Dupree. He's the future.
He's the future of the business.
No. What about Shawn Michaels? No fucking way, man.
RVD? Come on, guys. Stone Cold, RVD, Shawn Michaels?
Rene Dupree, Stone Cold, and Shawn Michaels. All the stars are here.
Hey, that's for Wrestling Noah next year.
This whole draft is all the stars are here.
It's literally just that meme in general.
Doesn't Rene Dupree get Fifi when he goes to SmackDown? I mean, the star.
Fifi is coming.
All the stars are here.
Sky's the limit for Rene Dupree, I'll tell you what.
It's like Rene Dupree, like it's actually crazy because Rene Dupree, it wasn't even bad at this point.
No, he's still
not bad, but they jabronied him so bad.
They hated this young piece of shit French bastard.
Well, yeah,
the segment following, Rene
Dupree comes out here and cuts the craziest, like, word to word little promo I've ever heard in my life. Rene Dupree grabs the mic and goes, I will die in hell before the last memory of me on Raw is Steve Austin giving me the stunner.
He legit says, I will die in hell.
Hey, why are you going to hell, man?
I will die in hell is the craziest shit I've ever heard.
You think they told? Yeah, you got there and you said, I'd rather die in hell.
No way. I bet they said, you need to say something that's like, oh, man, I really want to be out here, but I don't, you know, I don't want my last thing to be Steve Austin said. What did they tell me to say? I will die in hell.
He says, he demands one final match here in Detroit, Michigan. And Bischoff and Heyman look at him and say, yeah, all right, go on. And then they just leave. And then Renee says, I'm challenging any of the Raw jabronis in the locker room to face the French renom, Renard Dubra. Just fucking crazy-ass name pronunciation.
He should have kept that forever. Rene Dupree's finish should have been called Die in Hell.
Die in Hell? He should adopt that now in Noah.
Die in Hell?
Oh, that'd be crazy.
I was like, I switched so hard. He said, I would die in hell before I fucking lose this
yeah,
match.
That's number
I was like,
pick.
That's my guy. That's my number one pick.
He's on Paul Heyman SmackDown for a reason.
Yeah, he's a good pick here.
I like it.
Open challenge to the back, and out comes Chris Jericho.
Chris Jericho is pissed because he got cucked by Christian and Trish. I don't know if the word cuck was existing in 2004 yet, or else they would have said
it
100
no.
times on commentary. Jericho is very oily. He's wearing red and pink gear. He got betrayed at WrestleMania, and he is going to beat Rene Dupree's ass. So much so that he's going to beat him with an enziguri.
Holy shit.
What the fuck?
Dude, Jericho beats with an enziguri and Dupree like throws a shoulder up at 3.1.
Hey!
Chris Jericho
blue
will never ever forget March 14th. JR with these very specific dates. It always sounds like it is the darkest day in the history.
You're right. He will never forget that day ever.
March 14th. What the?
Rene does the French tickler. Lawler calls it a funny little French dance.
Fuck you, 20-year-old bastard.
You are fucking... You should die now. You're right. You should
when
do
Taz,
that.
When Taz used to do the thing, he would... I'm
a French
Taz
man.
To,
I do yeah, a French yeah, thing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I wish he would have just butted in here. Hey, he's on our show now. Ah, French man. Rene... So there's a little bit of miscommunication at some point here. Rene gets hung up on the second rope, and Jericho's going to do the running crotch to the back of his head. But Rene just gets off the rope. Jericho has to pick him up, punch him in the head, and put him back in position. He hits it.
Of course.
And then enziguris Rene. 1, 2, 3.
Fuck you, man.
What an exciting way to start off the draft.
They beat the number one draft kick by Insecurity.
Not even the walls.
Not even the walls.
Jericho, I will say this much. Jericho's look here was great. I love the velour tights with the this looked really cool here. But he beats him and then just leaves.
Yeah, uncomfortably leaves. He keeps looking back at Renee, and he doesn't walk up the ramp either. He goes off the side.
Shitty fucking match. You kept looking at him. Shitty fucking match.
It's a Geary bastard.
Blew this shit.
First 20-year-old, I'm shitting. I'm running it back right now to shit in your bag.
Good luck in Noah. So Dupree,
no chance.
Dupree gets back up. He doesn't even sell the Enziguri. It screams in the mic that he demands respect.
I'm not going to be cheated like this. Oh, here it goes.
Oh, shit. Sheriff Austin's here with ATV. Let's go.
Stone Cold is a crazy son of a bitch, man. He drives out on the ATV, swings around the corners of the ring, smashes into the announce table, circles
Holy
back around,
shit.
Drives by the announce table again, laughs at them, and then he gets in the ring. He goes to shake Rene Dupree's hand. Rene Dupree, of course, takes it because he's a 20-year-old piece of shit, takes a stunner, and Stone Cold drinks beers.
That's awesome.
That is this is the number one career ever.
He got paid so much more than Rene Dupree.
so much more. Steve Austin just having a good time, man. This is so sick. That's it for Monday Night Raw, everybody.
What'd you say,
Tony?
He got
free unlimited beer for the rest of his career for no reason. Yeah, that's my gimmick. I drink beer. I need free beer. That's my gimmick.
It's crazy, Tony, because he was just he didn't even ask for the high grade season. I was like Bush Light and Coors and like that's like $7.
You know,
that's awesome.
Oh shit.
We have the draft lottery town hall again as we come back from commercial.
But not before Rico and Jackie Gaeta are in the ring during their entrance. They're not a part of the draft. They're just
not
the
a part of the draft, and they're also in the ring. And anyways, Eric Bischoff.
Don't worry about them.
Why are they there?
I don't know. That was very strange.
Eric Bischoff says, you don't need to worry about calling them the world's greatest tag team anymore.
Oh, no. Evolution's breaking up.
No, first he says, if SmackDown's a better show, then why did McMahon choose to do this on Raw? Huh?
I mean, that's a fair question.
So they break up the world's greatest tag team.
Yes.
Obviously, they had plans here because Shelton Benjamin is coming to Raw.
And which, I mean, that works out for him at the beginning. Because this is around
super
like probably
kicked.
He does this. He that's I think that's is that 05? That might be a little bit after.
I'm not sure actually.
But he does get a pin over Triple H, doesn't he?
He does. That match was crazy.
Yeah,
I remember watching
he
that.
Does. He
did the T-bone suplex and
that's
beat
right.
him. Holy shit, that was crazy.
Yeah, that was awesome. That was like cool. That was that's a good reason to switch somebody to a show if you're gonna do something.
Sure.
Like
yeah,
that.
Exactly. Yeah. If you have plans for him, sure.
Yeah, yeah. Rene Dupree.
Rico and Jackie Gaeta are still in the ring.
Yes, they are.
Shelton Benjamin's career highlights in WWE. One of them is University of Minnesota.
They show Shelton Haas in the back. They're not happy. Behind them, also unhappy in SmackDown hat, is referee Mike Chioda.
Oh, man. I like reffing you guys.
I love calling your matches, guys.
Kane's pyro goes off.
Yeah, well, they're waiting for Shelton to come out to accept his Raw hat and shirt. But pyro goes off. Here comes fucking Kane. What happened to Shelton? Did he die? We set Shelton on fire? Why is no one concerned about the whereabouts of Shelton Benjamin here? Kane is here for a match.
Kane versus Rico with Jackie Gaeta is up next. Shelton didn't come out quick enough, so now we have to get out here to do this match.
Rico is throwing kicks at Kane, and Kane is selling them,
dude,
shockingly.
Dude, this is what happened. Kane hits the ring. Rico is giving Kane shots, and Rico is confused on why Kane is not cutting him off. So he's stopping
and throwing them.
He throws, kicks, throws, looks at him, gives him an opening. Okay, throws, kicks, throws, looks at him again, waits for an opening. I'm Kane. Kane, he keeps hitting, waiting for Kane to cut him off. Kane does it. Then Kane fucking choke slams him. Kane went out here and made Rico look as bad as humanly possible and beat him in 20 seconds.
And then he just flips backwards over the ropes, looks real cool, and leaves. That's
he
awesome.
Never even pans back over to Rico or Jackie Gato. Fuck y'all, man.
We also never hear about Shelton Benjamin for the rest of the day.
Where is he? Where'd he go?
What the fuck happened?
What the Shelton doing?
Kane gets to the top of the ramp here.
Listen.
He calls over Heyman and Bischoff. He needs double mics. I'm going to let you know, if double mics happened at an indie show, I think the arena would explode.
Holy
There's no. Yeah, you're right. But those mics so cool.
Speaking of mics, did you notice like some mic issues during this? Was it, the mics were fucked up, or did Heyman keep hitting the mic with his neck brace?
Oh, I don't know.
I kept noticing like random like mic twitches. It was very annoying.
It must
like,
have been Heyman messing
happening?
With the mic on his thing.
He was so doing it on purpose.
Yeah. Paul Heyman's fucking show. Kane grabs Bowman and says, "You two listen close." He's very breathy here. "It doesn't matter where I end up, but I better not be on the same show as Rene Dupree."
I'm a French man, and I'm doing French tickler.
I don't want to see it. No, he's talking about The Undertaker, of course. He doesn't want to be the same show as The Undertaker. And Kane does the pyro and then leaves. He does the pyro. It shows the ring. Rico and Jackie Gator are nowhere to be found.
What happened to him? Where'd they go?
I don't know. With Shelton.
Yeah, they're with Shelton. Paul Heyman then draws a name, and he smiles, and he looks down, and he looks there and goes, "Oops." It looks like they're breaking up another tag team.
Another super group, he says.
Holy shit, man.
Here, all right, so it's Panda. It's Evolution. Evolution.
It's got to be Evolution, right? There,
Tony,
Evolution.
This could be worse than the first one. And you know what? Could be is wrong. This is worse than the first one because I am in the trenches. I have very little to no memory of this being a team. Mark Jindrak is the member that is going to SmackDown, breaking up the supergroup of listener, think about it. Who would Mark Jindrak be teaming up with that they're breaking up here?
Triple H, Batista, and Ric Flair. And
you
right?
Almost, Tony. James, you want to take a shot at that?
I think it's gotta be Charlie Haas and Mark Jindrak.
Supergroup.
You guessed it. Garrison Cade. Supergroup. What the fuck?
Bro, this lottery is
crazy.
Did you already mention that JR will no longer be able to point to the superstar and call him Blue Chipper?
Oh, yes. That's right. Heyman did say.
What he
unfortunately, JR will not be called a chipper. Now there goes a Blue Chipper because SmackDown welcomes Mark Jindrak. And Mark Jindrak's accomplishments in the WWE are he was a WCW tag champion.
That was weird. His only highlight, WCW tag champion.
I also don't remember that theme song he used. Very strange.
Oh, man. This is, I can't believe the all-star team of Mark Jindrak and
Garrison Cade, of course.
Garrison Cade. Have been broken up.
Well, so devastating.
Draft lottery returns after commercial.
Raw, whatever.
Eric Bischoff now has his specs on.
He says Raw is the home of good-looking people, and the next pick is really going to bring it home. Raw picks Nydia. So they show Nydia. Didn't recognize her. She like her hair looked totally different. It was crazy.
Yeah, she looked way different. Yeah, this is post Jamie Noble. My bad.
Yeah, Eric Bischoff. That's right.
Yes,
Jamie Noble is also coming with Nia.
Sorry, he's in ROH right now, actually. So no,
he's
not.
The champ. So Nydia's accomplishments were, of course, she won Tough Enough, and her accomplishments are also her measurements of 38, 24, and 36.
That's awesome.
That's crazy.
Of course, Nydia is excited to go for the women's title.
That's what she says.
She's also excited to take her shirt off with her bra out.
She takes her shirt off because she wants to put on the Raw shirt, of course. And JR says, I think she's going to leave her mark here right on Raw. Nydia is released in November.
Well, Paul Heyman says, "Yeah, yeah, yeah. I hope you go blind again.
Sorry about that.
I hope you go blind again.
I hope you go blind again." He does say that. John Cena's music hits.
Do, 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 do.
And Taz says, "The doctor."
What does Michael Cole say, though?
What does he say?
Oh, my.
Oh, he does say that. Sorry, I think I have like an oh, my blocker in my head.
I was like, he was doing oh, my here, too?
That's what crazy. I don't remember that.
Yo, Cena is
crazy here.
Listen.
Blue jersey, U.S. title, the thickest chain with fucking padlock ever.
Yeah, this was this when I was young. I thought this is that dude right here.
This was the guy. Yeah,
yeah,
was,
yeah.
This, oh man. Cena says the franchise crashing this party. Paul, don't get hot at me. He's wearing a neck brace because he's blowing the whole lottery. You see, because he's saying he sucks at penises, Tony.
Yeah, of course.
He says, "I'm a lottery pick. They both want to get their hands on. This ain't no junior high dance, so fellas, keep your pants on." He said, because they would want to fuck him, Tony.
Paul Heyman, you suck penis.
You want to fuck
penis
me?
Penis sucker!
You want to fuck me, Paul? You look like you want to have sex with me. "And if you draft me, save your t-shirts. I ain't kissing your butts." That's what he says, butts. "We are in the D, baby, so you can choke on D's nuts." And he throws a pack of nuts at Paul Heyman, who slaps
D's
away.
D's nuts back in 2004? Yeah, holy shit.
I remember D's nuts when jokes when I was going to school. I don't know how it resurged in like 2020, but.
Yeah, you're right.
Oh, Heyman smacked.
He smacked his nuts.
You mentioned he smacks him away.
Smacks
he throws them at
the
Heyman, and Heyman was able to smack it out of the air.
That was
get out of here.
With a broken freaking neck.
That's pretty crazy.
Cena says, "You're the general manager, but I'm making the next pick." And Cena just reaches into the tumbler and takes out a ball. And he says, "I'm giving you one ball, but you still got no
dick."
Yes, dick. Paul Heyman has one ball and no cock. What the fuck happened
there? It could have been anything, actually. It could have been like pews.
Yeah, I guess maybe the fans. The Detroit is they need to get it together there, mate. It could have been anything.
So.
But if Paul Heyman does have one ball and no dick, that is crazy.
That's ECW style.
Giant Gonzalez style.
Paul Heyman says, "That is not my pick," and Bischoff says, "Yes, it is, you bitch. Now open it now."
Why is that allowed? Heyman just says, "Oh, all right." Why does Heyman just agree? What the fuck?
I am not entirely sure.
Well, Heyman is happy about it in the end of this, of course.
Well, he shouldn't be, but
well.
Paul draws Triple H.
He says, "Bischoff, you sure you want me to take this pick?" And he says, you own it. You wrote it down. You
wrote it, and
it.
I read it. I'm reading it.
And Triple H is going to SmackDown. He spits water all over the locker room. Flair and Batista are pissed. Kane is laughing in the back. We come back from the commercial. Locker room is chanting, "Na na na na."
Na 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 na.
Na 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 na. Hey. Goodbye. Triple H throws his water bottle at them. Teddy Long puts on his thinking face as he leaves. I don't know why he did that.
I am thinking.
Thinking emoji. Evil thinking.
This is like the famous Triple H spit take, though. This is pretty cool to see this in real time as it's happening.
Yeah, it's cool.
Kane isn't laughing in the back like a little freak.
That's how he laughs.
Yeah. Christian versus Spike Dudley up next.
I actually thought this match was fun as hell.
Yeah, I mean, they're both really good.
They are real good.
Christian's with Trish Stratus.
Do they explain? Maybe I missed it. Because last Monday, Trish hit... Christian jumped Spike on the ramp before his match, and then Trish hit him with a chick kick, and Christian with the unprettier on the floor. Why?
Look, man, I don't really care about that. What I care about here is Christian... What is Christian wearing
at
this moment?
That long sleeve? Holy fuck.
This dude had belt boot cuts, mustard and ketchup long sleeve tee. That
like
was a schmedium.
It looked like an antique shop rug.
He is wearing a rugged wear watch. This is not like a nice watch. This is a I'm going to go hiking watch.
This is
the craziest fit I've ever seen. And he beats
awesome.
Spike Dudley's ass.
He whoops his ass. I don't know why he jumped him, but he did. So Spike
fuck
rushes
you,
down.
Spike Dudley.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
You bitch.
Yeah, pretty much.
Oh, I was watching, you know, speaking of Rene Dupree, by the way, you know, he has a podcast and he like, it's actually good because he just lets people, he just called, has them come on and he stay, he's like very close to the camera so you can see half of Rene's face and he just lets them talk about
yeah,
the
that's awesome.
Yeah, it's fucking great. I think he said Spike Dudley is a stooge. I think that's what he said.
That's awesome.
Rene Dupree's like one of my favorite pro wrestling Noah guys.
I love him and RVD there. So Spike rushes down in the ring. He hits him with a Spike Dudley headbutt
super
from the video.
Crazy. Hell yeah. So, crazy for that.
Hell yeah, Tony. He got a two count off the SVR
WB
Spike Dudley
Games,
headbutt.
Yeah. SVR headbutt. Let's go.
A two count is crazy off that move, by the way.
Off the headbutt. He's got to put the online scene over, bro.
I hated playing online. Fuck, dude.
I definitely put that in all my guys' movesets.
9 foot tall, big ass cock, 100 overall demon CAW, and he's got the fucking Spike Dudley headbutt. Fuck no. You, man.
Yeah, Spike gets a two off the Spike Dudley. Christian's in the deadlock gear, by the way. Shouts out.
I like this gear for Christian.
The RNG, yeah, I love that shit.
I think it looks kind of cool. I mean, he's got like the three. I always thought like the whole three-piece gear is kind of crazy. Like wearing the tights like underneath the, or like
the
over
trunks.
The,
yeah,
the trunks
yeah, yeah.
Over,
the, trunks
the,
over
tights
the tights. Yeah, yeah.
Is
that
crazy.
Is crazy.
But it's a cool look.
Christian goes to scoop slam Spike. Spike turns it into a DDT. That looked cool for a two count. Christian goes for a suplex. Spike turns it into a roll-up for two. He's just like transitioning into pins over and over again. I thought that was fucking pretty sweet. Spike double stomps the shit out of Christian. Another Spike Dudley video game classic that I spammed.
Hell yeah.
The top rope double stomp. Yeah. Christian throws Spike in the ring post and then hits him with the unprettier for the win.
The Spike Dudley one was cheese because he landed on his feet. If you do the double
foot
stomp
and
you go to your knees,
you're right. Yeah, yeah.
But he goes to his feet, so you can just go straight back to other moves. It's fucked up.
You can go right back up and do another one.
Yeah, that's messed up.
Spike Dudley was a stooge.
You could have bashed that, brother.
Jerry Lawler on commentary is jerking off to the idea of Christian and Trish making out. JR says, how could a woman like that want her hair pulled?
What the?
And then King goes, I'll explain it to you after the show.
So we go to a draft lottery town hall again.
Yes.
Bischoff is not fucking happy that Triple H is not on his show anymore.
No.
This isn't fair.
It's not fair. I gotta find Mr. McMahon. So he runs backstage.
He does.
He just runs away.
He runs to the interview spot like he's playing one of the video games and goes,
you're right.
Oh, well, I'll be goddamn. There he is. Hey.
It's like when you play Just Bring It and you can run around backstage in first person. Or I guess Shut Your Mouth had that too. And you just, there's just people standing there and you just walk up to them.
Yeah.
Oh, my brother.
Vince is chilling and they have a conversation about Triple H switching off shows here.
Yeah, Bischoff says, Heyman didn't make the pick. Cena made the pick. This isn't fair. And Vince says, it is what it is, bro.
he says, once the pick has been chosen, it's official. Like, it's out of my hands, man.
Nothing
like,
I can do.
I could not do anything. I don't run this fucking company at all.
I didn't make these rules. Nothing I could do. And Heyman walks in, excuse me, I have an idea. Tonight, the WWE title gets defended by Eddie Guerrero. Eddie defends the WWE title against SmackDown's newest acquisition, Triple H. And Bishop says, you can't do that. This is my show, bro. And Vince says, yeah, bro, you out of your mind? And Amos says, well, I'm doing what you would do.
Yeah, right, out of your mind, bitch.
So Vince says, I got to look after both brands, you know. So this match, Eddie versus Triple H, it's going to happen tonight.
He says, it will, in fact, happen tonight.
It will, in fact, happen tonight. All right. And everyone's waiting for your next pick. So get on out there, please. So
yeah,
they just go back out.
So they'd go back to the stage. Yeah.
This whole thing is crazy, like the Vince thing, because they announce a WWF title match tonight.
Yeah.
And it's just randomly made an hour into the show. On guys that were just traded.
Yeah.
On Raw. And it was SmackDown guys.
The draft
yeah.
isn't even over. Eddie might be on Raw after this.
Vince almost said WWF title also.
He would have fucking.
He said Eddie Guerrero versus Triple H for the WWF. We're going to have the match tonight.
He would have looked at Heyman and said, why'd you make me say that shit? And headbutt him.
You're going to OVW.
You're out of here, you bastard.
Now that you mention it, James, that is a crazy match to just do halfway through the show. Eddie and Triple H, like a huge fucking match.
That's like a money match on any... Dude, yeah.
That's like built to a pay-per-view match, yeah.
As far as cage match goes, it is the only time Triple H and Eddie Guerrero were ever in a match together in any capacity. Ever.
That's crazy.
No tags, no six-mans, nothing. Only time ever is this match
crazy.
Here.
I didn't know that. That's pretty insane, actually.
How is that? Eddie's been in the company since, what, 01? 2000?
And Triple H still...
He was on... Yeah, what the fuck?
Yo, I can't wait to get to that match.
No.
We go back to the stage. Bischoff ends up drafting Rhino.
Well, he says, I'm not going to be upstaged by Heyman. And whoever I draft next, I don't care if it's, he says this, I don't care if it's Big Show or if it's Michael Cole, whoever I pick is facing world champion Chris Benoit for the belt tonight. What the fuck? My next pick is a man who has tremendous amount of admiration for and a man who can match the intensity of Benoit from the Motor City of Detroit.
He's on the world's greatest tag team. He is the blue chipper.
Rhino. They show, like, he says from Detroit, and they show the shot of the backstage area. No one in the backstage also knows who's from Detroit. they didn't figure it out immediately. I also was confused. Rhino celebrates. He does the you can't see me taunt in front of Cena's face and then leaves. They show his list of accomplishments. They don't list that he was the ECW TV champion, which I was tilted about, and I wrote down here.
He threw his shirt at Paul Heyman.
He threw his shirt.
Why do you do that shit?
And then took the Raw shirt and put it on. Yeah. Who's the fucking man?
WWF Rewind brought to you by
WWE.
Snicker Cruncher.
WWE.
What did you just say?
WWE.
WWF Rewind brought to you by Snicker Cruncher. Eat this or die.
Is that what it is?
No, I don't know what
it
was.
Okay, because I believe it.
Crunch these nuts.
Yeah, crunch this.
So Booker and RVD versus Flair and Batista for the WWF tag titles is up next.
We're going to go three segs here for this one.
Yeah, holy shit, man.
Dude. What is this RVD Booker theme song?
What the fuck? I do not remember this at all. What the
it's
hell?
The Booker Man, y'all.
This is crazy.
It's the Booker Man.
It's the Booker Man, y'all.
Then it cuts and it goes, can you dig it?
Then it cuts to RVD or Booker T's original theme.
I don't know if I even remember this. This is crazy.
When I heard it's the Booker Man, y'all, one of a kind, I thought I was going fucking. I had two streams open.
That's what I thought. I thought I watched like a YouTube video in the background or something. Yeah. It's the Booker Man, y'all. It's not like hate the player, hate the game or anything. No. It's just it's the Booker Man, y'all.
And I'm Rob.
This is crazy, man.
Yo, you gotta let me on this track.
RVD.
According to XYLOT, there's three versions of this theme song.
There's a what?
There's three different versions of this theme song. Yes, of this song.
Holy fuck.
Yeah, also on the fucking match card before the match, it throws me off every time I see RVD without the wrist tape.
I know. I was like, what's wrong here? I was like, is it elbow pads? I was like, oh, it's wrist tape. Why is
it
fuck,
man? He wears
man?
Huge wrist tape. Yeah.
I know. Fucking crazy. Damn it. Well, Raw is also brought to you by Walking Tall. Ninja Gaiden on Xbox. Unleash your...
The Ninja original Gaiden. Ninja Gaiden. That's crazy.
Ninja Gaiden on Xbox. Unleash your inner ninja.
All right.
And YJ Stinger.
I've Fuck never, you.
Did you,
that's,
did you ever...
That's
did
YJ Stinger.
Ever
and YJ Stinger. Go, Fuck you.
YJ Stinger. Go to hell and die. So here comes Flair and Batista, this goodbye evolution sign with a strange head drawn on it for some reason in the crowd. Mm-hmm. I don't know what that's about. Flair is wearing his black tights with the red RF logo on it, but wearing purple boots and knee pads, so he's checked out.
Fuck.
This match goes for fucking ever, man.
Yeah. No, it
and
does.
I feel, like, I feel like they were like lost a lot too. You know, they were like there was a lot of miscommunication. Like Flair would do something, and there was, something would be mistimed. Flair would beg off, and Booker would go for something, and then like almost blow his ankles out, having to stop himself. There's a JR Bleeds Gravy sign in the crowd.
What the fuck,
RVD?
Man.
RVD. So Booker does the. He pulls Flair off the top. Flair dies. RVD tags in while on the top rope. I don't know if that's legal. I think they say that on commentary too.
If he has, did he have one? Was he on the, fully on the top rope or 1 foot on the apron?
1 foot on rope. 1 foot on the top rope.
Ooh, that's a tough one. I don't.
He might have been holding the tag rope though.
Yeah, that's true. I don't know. I don't know the rules on that. Referee's discretion on that.
Of course, he hits the 5-star on Flair, covers him, and then rolls out of the ring because Batista comes in to attack him. And Raw rolls on after this. What the fuck?
Okay.
What
well, now it's time for Raw Zone, baby.
What happened there? What the fuck happened? That was weird. Batista goes for the Batista bomb. Already hits a jumping back kick to try to break it up, but he kicks Booker T in the fucking head instead.
No.
And then gets shit canned out, and Batista hits the Batista bomb, and Batista and Flair are your new tag team champions.
Oh, wow.
Actually, kind of a cool finish there.
It was a very cool finish. And the match wasn't, like, dog shit. It was just long and
yeah,
awkward.
Yeah, just super long.
Yeah, I felt it was very long, yeah.
Batista looks crazy here,
He
man.
Does.
He is, seeping juice.
Yeah, big style.
Chicken breasts.
yeah, he's two chicken breasts, one asparagus. Flair and Batista are the new tag champs on Raw.
Yes. And the super group is no longer a group anymore.
Yeah, we already talked about Mark Jindrak. Draft lottery town hall. Eric Bischoff picks
Mr. Thursday Night Rob Van Dam.
Van Dam.
Oh, damn.
Michael Cole yells out, check out the stats. RVD just lost.
Is the GOAT. I don't make the rules, man. This
he's
is the
man.
Greatest. This is like the dude right here.
I love RVD, man.
Yeah, he's the shit.
They go backstage. And
this is
RVD...
awesome, by the way, the backstage segment here.
It's cool because it's Booker T and RVD backstage. Booker's like, yeah, we're going to get the belts back. You know, we got that rematch clause. And he said, that was a little mistake. Don't worry about it, bro. You're cool. We'll get back. Which is cool because, you know, usually wrestling tropes are, oh, you fucking kicked me in the head and you definitely did it on purpose and I'm going to fucking kill you now.
Yeah.
But Booker's like,
yeah,
nah, bro. That's cool, bro.
This is pretty compelling.
Yeah. They're like, okay, we'll just, you know, we get a rematch clause. We'll just fucking do it again. Coach walks in and says, nah, bump that. You get
no
the rematch.
Dick eating is crazy. You are not getting a tag title match.
You just got drafted to SmackDown, you idiot. And RVD's, what, are you serious? He goes, what are you talking about, man? We're a team. Coach said, no, you're fucking out of here, man. See ya. And then leaves.
And leaves. RVD gives the pogo face.
You're right.
This is crazy. Yo.
That's a cool angle, though.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty cool too. I thought that Booker not being like, you know, shit happens sort of thing, you know, like
yeah,
whatever.
Fuck you, man. Why'd you kick me, man?
Obviously, he didn't mean to kick him in the head or anything.
Why'd
you
do that on purpose?
So then we get Chris Benoit versus Rhino up next
for the world title.
Drakengard is sponsoring WWE Backlash.
Now, this is what I was waiting for, James. What the fuck is Drakengard?
I've heard of Drakengard. I never played Drakengard.
Tony, do you know what Drakengard is?
They've made a couple.
It's an RPG game, right? I don't know what it is.
No,
though.
It's a Japanese RPG
game,
I think.
Okay. Yeah. And it's sponsoring the pay-per-view.
Yeah, I think...
you said they made a couple of them.
Yeah, I know they made at least three.
Okay. Oh, wow. Okay.
Let me see here.
Yeah. Because I genuinely never heard of it. Deb immediately accused me of having played it because she thinks I'm just a fucking video game nerd to play every fucking game.
Yeah,
I didn't know
I think
right.
Drakengard has something to do with Nier, if you ever played...
I have not, but I know of that game. I know of Nier.
I think it's like a... I don't know too much about it, but
sure,
I think it's in the same line.
Oh, okay.
I think it's in the same line of games.
Okay.
Yeah, it's an alternative timeline set after a different ending of the first Drakengard game.
You know what? Okay. That sounds very exciting.
Nier Automata, by the way, is goated. If you guys have not played that shit, I went Nier Automata sponsored DPW because that shit is crazy.
I've been playing that all the time.
You don't know anything about it.
Oh, fuck you.
You never played it. You yeah, don't well, know no, about 2B and A2. You weren't there.
I'll fucking whoop
I was
in,
there.
I'll whoop your ass in Halo 2 anytime, Sean. You
want to
fucking...
If you, know, you really want to take this to yeah, the streets that, of Halo 3 yeah, 101, Xbox
Halo
360
2,
edition,
Halo 3
title
together,
update,
and that's three.
I will spin your ass
one
in a
two
circle.
Three.
You talking to me,
one and two
Guardian,
is three.
BR only, rifles on map, sniper, no overshield, OS not there. I will slap it up.
Yeah, I got all that and then some.
Your Automata is a good game.
All right, that's good. And Drakengard is a bad game.
DPW No Pressure was
it's
good.
DPWOnDemand.com.
Some guy's walking by at the beginning of this match, just holding up a Austin middle finger, foam finger, just walking by. I thought that was great. So sick. Rhino goes for a powerbomb out of the corner. Benoit hits him in the head, and Rhino alley-oops him into the buckle, which I think is an underrated move. I love me a good alley-oop.
Alley-oop.
Rhino puts Benoit in the sharpshooter. JR, I swear, said, what the hell is this?
He did. He didn't know what this was.
He had no idea what the fuck Rhino was going for, which, what the fuck? Rhino, which I guess was weird, because I don't know how often I've seen Rhino do a submission. So it
this was
little,
awesome. Rhino yeah. gets a sharpshooter. Benoit actually sells the sharpshooter for like a good 30 seconds. It was actually a pretty
it
good
was, it,
like,
I
move
bought
here.
It. I was like, oh, fuck. Are they like, is Rhino debuting like a move here? What is going on
and
here?
And then Benoit ends up selling it until he can figure out enough to leverage himself to the rope.
Yes.
This is sweet. This match is good.
Benoit takes Rhino down to go for a sharpshooter, but Rhino gets the rope. So he's both kind of just doing a lot of fucking back and forth work here. Rhino goes for the gore. Benoit moves. Rhino bumps the fucking buckle, turns around, crossface, and Rhino taps out. Benoit retains the world title shockingly here in a match that was just booked 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, Benoit gives Rhino the three Germans here, and he was so
Woo!
Nice on these.
Throwing,
was,
yeah, yeah, yeah. It all, but it still looks fucking sweet, though.
No, no, it's you're great. That's probably why like people are cool yeah. with it, you know.
Yeah,
I feel
yeah.
like Kurt was way more vicious with his. Benoit was like Benoit was good at giving you your bump, and I thought
yeah.
this was cool.
Yeah,
Diving Headbutt looked great. The he
Rhino
tried to go
big, by the way.
He is. Like, he's not as big as he was in TNA. He gets bigger. Actually,
he does get bigger. I just yeah. it fucking boggles my mind how Rhino, like, how many titles did Rhino have in WWE? I don't feel like, I feel like it wasn't many.
No, definitely. No, I don't think so.
Or how many world title shots he actually
know,
got. Hardcore, of course, everyone fucking. Yeah. He had the, oh yeah, he had the WCW US title in WWE. I don't remember that. And he was SmackDown Tag Champion with Heath Slater.
Oh yeah, that wow, that was a long time
He was never
later.
Intercontinental champ?
He had that Intercontinental match with Kane that one time. That was pretty good.
That was a good one, you're right. That was pretty cool. Fucking Rhino's awesome.
WWE cared about work rate at all. Like, I feel like Benoit probably could have been champion for a while. Like, obviously this match was kind of just put together, and like they were able to come up with some pretty unique shit to kind of play this one out. So that was kind of
yeah,
cool.
That's true.
I think Benoit only holds the title till SummerSlam.
That's when he drops it to Orton, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
We go backstage. Shawn Michaels comes up to Eric Bischoff.
Bischoff.
With the creepiest smile I've ever seen. This is a weird bastard.
It's awkward.
It is, because they also have it like separate. From like the, they're at the interview segment. They're like at the backstage interview spot.
He's watching the monitor.
But yeah, so they're like off to the side, so you can see the light boxes on the everything.
Yeah,
and
yeah, yeah.
Air conditioning's kicking fucking hard on this one. Going crazy.
So Sean walks up and he pats Bischoff on the shoulder, and Bischoff turns around and he says, "Looks like the world title is safely intact around the waist of Chris Benoit. You know, as much as I want a shot at Benoit." Note that, by the way, as much as I want a shot at Benoit, this thing with Triple H and myself is far from over. And now that Triple H is traded, you got two choices. Choice number one is you trade me to SmackDown. And actually, there's only one choice, so trade me to SmackDown. I'm not going to do that, but I'm going to be behind you 100% like never before. And at our next pay-per-view, you're going to get a shot at the title. And HBK says, you know what? That's fine. Very quick to solve this issue. He didn't care about the shot at the title. He wanted Triple H. All right, how about a shot at the title? Bet. He said, what better way to get back at Triple H than to take the one thing that means to him? And he says, this time the kick is going to stick. Did you like that line, Tony?
Yeah, it's great. I remember that. The famous Shawn Michaels line. The kick will stick. You don't remember that?
No, Brett never said
Shawn Michaels.
I know that much.
Yeah, no
he
way.
Did it, when he did it to Brett, he said the kick will stick.
And then he beat him?
Yeah, he said the kid every time stick he never to lost Bray. He said he also said I'm a little bitch. I'm a little bitch boy. Oh my god,
that one too.
Yeah, that was like his famous line. They made like four shirts with it,
but he never got pinned by Brett, so it didn't matter. You know,
that's also fair though. He didn't.
Yeah, Brett didn't pin a lot of people. He made them tap like little bitches.
That is also true.
He didn't do that either, Deshaun. So it doesn't matter.
He didn't tap on his right. He didn't tap on mine as well. That's true.
Yeah, wrestling's fake.
So, yeah, I bet it is. Got nothing else, huh?
Tony Slam of the Week brought to you by Dragon Guard. What the fuck is this, James?
Hey, Slam of the Week brought you by Dragon Guard.
Near automation or whatever, James.
Molly
said,
Holly is bald.
Near automation.
You're on Tombada. Oh my god, man. Sheesh.
Fucking hell. Typical Bret Hart fan.
Oh my god.
Yeah, don't even tell me you put near automation.
Oh my god, here we go.
Well, Molly Holly comes out with the wig on, and then Lita rips the wig off, and JR says, "That is really hideous." Why was Molly Holly's whole gimmick as, wow, look how fucked up this girl is.
The slam of the week. Molly Holly is bald, everybody. Thank you, Dragon Guard, for sponsoring this segment.
This woman is ugly, Dragon Guard.
Based. Draft Lottery Town Hall.
Here we go. Coming to Bischoff. Who's coming to Raw, James?
Who does he draft? Who does he draft? Who does he draft?
It's, of course, Pro Wrestling Noah's own Tajiri.
He's here!
The Japanese buzzsaw. Akio and Sakota are not happy about this in the back, who were with Tajiri at the time. And then Tajiri hugs them and cries because he knows they're both about to get fired.
No!
Sorry about that.
Yeah. Holy shit.
So yeah, Tajiri is going to Raw. Heyman says, "You can do the whole cap and shirt routine. I'm bored." SmackDown is pleased to announce the former member of the Raw roster. His mic is breaking up as he does this. A very good friend of mine, Theodore Long. And they go backstage and show the shot of Theodore Long, who is very happy about this. Jazz, who he manages, is not happy, and Teddy Long does not care.
And then Jazz says, "I don't really care either. I made more money without you anyway."
Fuck yeah.
Teddy Long gets drafted, and Taz and Michael Cole say, believe that on commentary.
Believe that, player, and player.
Eric Bischoff then draws Edge to Raw.
Former Internet Continental Champion is what he
but
says.
But he's not even here. Okay. Though. How so can he get drafted? He's not even here.
They obviously
Tony, you know what's funny about that? They explained this at the top of the show, and he was there, and he heard it.
He's not even here right now. How's he gonna get drafted? What are you doing here?
Why can just hear Vince McMahon going, "I don't have to fucking say that. You're confusing them.
Tell them. Remind those idiots.
Say no commentary
here." Fucking Edge's. Obviously, I think they dub this because it's usually Rob Zombie. But was this dubbed the Raw theme or? Or was it actually they just played the Raw theme because they didn't want to play Edge's music to give away the pop when he comes out later?
Oh, maybe.
I don't know.
Because they they dub Edge's theme with his, you know, "You Think You Know Me" regular one.
Sure.
Over the Rob Zombie one later. Here, it's just the Raw theme. So I don't know. So if anyone has the OG of this, tell us what they use for this part.
Yeah, for sure.
Heyman says, "Wipe that smile off your face before I wipe it off for you anyway." To pick up the pace like we do on SmackDown. Our final pick of the evening is... And then Heyman throws the pick away. And Bischoff goes and picks it up and says...
This is crazy. This is crazy.
Bischoff picks it up and says, "Wow, congratulations, SmackDown gets Spike Dudley."
Hey, come on. Come on, man. That's
fucked
up. Well,
Heyman's like, "That little fucking stooge is coming on."
And AD Priest said, "That bitch."
Damn it. With the headbutt cheese.
Stooge
they're never going to patch
Dudley,
this
fucking bitch.
They're never going to patch this.
Patch.
Ha 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 ha! SmackDown says, well, at least on SmackDown, I'll have someone to pick on. Anyway, so here's our final member.
Dude, holy shit,
they
man.
Shit on Spike Dudley so crazy here. What the fuck?
That's crazy. Yeah,
just
that is
fuck
nuts.
This little fucker.
They start out with Renee Dupree and end with Spike Dudley. Wow.
Well, don't worry,
fuck?
Tony. It's not over just yet because Raw has one more pick here. And Eric Bischoff's final pick is Paul Heyman. Oh my
man.
God. Vince said anybody.
Wait, what?
Can,
how does
every,
that work?
That
how
means
you,
everybody, Tony.
That?
Everybody can be drafted.
How
Paul
did that?
Heyman.
Yeah, Tony. How did that happen? Oh my God. Paul Heyman.
Tell him that
here.
Was explained to him
He's
earlier.
He's not here.
Tell him that was explained to him earlier.
We said it at the top. WWF. Fuck E. So they show the SmackDown locker room celebrating that Paul Heyman got drafted, which I thought was pretty cool. The Raw locker room is not happy that Paul Heyman's coming to Raw. Bischoff says, this is going to work out great because I could use some help. You know, I got some laundry I need taken care of. My car needs to be washed. Yeah. I got an internet bill, a phone bill. All inter-
got WWE champions to play.
Yeah. $10,000 in champions. Got to get that rocking here. Heyman says, listen, man, I would rather go die in hell than
with Renee Dupree.
I would die in hell before I go to Raw. I'll tell you that much.
He said, I will never sell my soul to a piece of slime like you. Screw you. I quit. And he leaves. And then Bischoff says, all right. No problem.
He said, the good guys win again.
Another one for the good guys. He says, I've stood up to two general managers. I've stood up to Stone Cold, and I'll make it clear the talent on both rosters. Eric Bischoff is back in a damn big way. My way. And then, oh my God, Edge is here. What the fuck? How is he here? They told me he wasn't going to be here.
He's not even here.
Tell him to say that he could be here. Y'all so fucking Barry Spike Dudley.
Fuck him.
So fuck Edge you, gets, Spike.
Edge comes down. He gets in the ring and then spears Bischoff. And Bischoff's head hits the bottom
oh
turnbuckle.
My God.
That's so
oh
fucked because Bischoff didn't want to take it. His head bounces off the bottom turnbuckle.
He killed him, man.
Why
that was fucking crazy.
Why did he do that?
I don't Dude, know. I loved it, though.
I couldn't even believe
what
that Bischoff took the meanest, like, he didn't even bump for it. He just
died. No, he dies, oh, bro. It was
Edge is in the craziest attire in the world, by the way.
What is this
he somehow found pleather pants with stars on the side of them and the biggest Goldberg-ass jacket I have ever seen in my life, man. This guy came out and thought he was Goldberg and speared Eric Bischoff.
That's right. He does the rock spot.
This is crazy, man.
That's right. He all. By the way,
nah, man. The dick eating's crazy.
He doesn't change to Metalingus until November of this year. So he's still using Rob Zombie here.
I mean, that's good.
Yeah,
good.
No, it is very good.
Metalingus can metaling my balls in its mouth.
Analingus is what I would prefer.
So Triple H versus Eddie Guerrero, once in a lifetime, legit.
WWE title on the line, the only time they've ever wrestled each other ever, as far as I know. At least
That's
singles,
crazy.
For sure. For sure singles, but I don't think they've been involved in a match together ever, which is
crazy.
Insane.
It is.
Triple H comes out with the Raw shirt on and rips it off to expose the SmackDown shirt, which is I vividly remember that in my brain, like him doing that.
They go crazy on commentary for it. Why is he wearing a Raw shirt? Hey, you can't wear a Raw shirt. Why is he, he's on SmackDown.
Bitch.
Why is he wearing a Raw shirt?
You're right. He is also gigantic here, by the way, not using steroids.
Who? Triple H? This whole main event?
Yeah. The whole scene.
Dude, Eddie looks like he's about to burst out of his skin. Like, it looks like
his shoulders are about to explode.
It's stretched to its max. This is like... Yeah, this is insane.
That's fucking nuts. He comes out and he tilts the lowrider on its side and it looks like it's going to flip over. I was very horrified. But he gets a big Eddie chant, which was pretty cool, going up against Triple H here. They start the match. Eddie extends the hand. Triple H goes to take it, but Eddie then smacks his ass in his direction.
He wipes his own ass with his own hand.
That wow. is... With his own hand? He does it?
I wipe my own ass!
I know, that's buddy!
I know! Why do you win? Because I do! I win!
That's Eddie Guerrero.
That's Eddie, yeah. So Triple H throws Eddie into the stairs at one point and fucking destroys him with it. That was crazy. A bunch of back and forth here. A lot of Triple H on top, of course, but Eddie.
This was a well-worked TV match. They start off with the International, which is insane. Seeing Triple H take a hip toss and arm drag from the smaller dude is always like crazy, but Triple H was never afraid to bump for dudes like that.
No. Dude, Triple H took a tilt-a-whirl head scissors from Eddie here.
Yeah, and the crowd popped for it. Good stuff. Yeah. I mean, Triple H was on top for a very long time, but that's kind of how it works. Everything was good in this match and fine, like, until it gets down to like the end of it.
So Eddie does a jump back off the second tornado DDT for a two count, which was cool. Eddie goes for the Three Amigos, but then here comes Flair and Batista wearing their Raw shirts. Now, during this match, by the way, it is Cole and Taz commentating this because it is a SmackDown match. Once Flair and Batista come out, it changes the JR and Lawler commentating, which
that was awesome. That was crazy. Love that. Yeah.
I was so thrown off. I was like, what just happened? I was like, oh, because it's Raw now. Okay. Triple H hits a DDT on Eddie. Flair distracts the ref. Batista gives Triple H the title. Cena and Rey come out to attack Batista, whooping his ass. Triple H goes to hit Eddie with the belt. Shawn Michaels gets in the ring, sweet chin music to Triple H, and then hits a house show dive on a pile of people on the outside.
I have never seen a group of people catch somebody as
so
well,
nicely.
As well as it was like everybody knew their career was on the line if they didn't
especially
catch
Ric his, Flair.
Catch this house show dive. Somebody was going to get fucking killed backstage, and it was going to be Spike Dudley.
So Sean hits him with the sweet chin music. Eddie goes up for the frog splash. I'm like, whoa, does Eddie fucking win here? That's awesome. He's the champ. That makes sense. That's cool. Eddie goes for the frog splash. Christian crotches him on the top rope. Disqualification. I should have known better.
Holy fucking shit.
I should have fucking known.
Holy,
the crowd was so hot, man.
Fucking shit.
This is the WWE champion.
Cannot believe that Triple H wouldn't just take the frog splash pin for this one. You could have kicked out at 3.1.
Yeah, you're right.
The crowd was so ready
they
for
it. So, and they never go back to it, which
they
is even
never
worse.
Return to it,
no,
which is...
No, man.
Yeah, that's insane. I don't
Fuck,
know.
Fuck, man. Crazy.
I mean, especially so, after Eddie sold his ass off for Triple H in this one. Like, it was a lot of Triple H doing his shit, and Eddie was selling like crazy for him.
Hell yeah.
You couldn't just take the frog splash finish, even after the interference from HBK? I don't
and
know,
the,
bro.
The
that's
splash,
a little weird, bro. I'm just going to say.
Everyone, the frog splash is made. He beat Brock with this fucking thing.
Yeah.
Beat fucking Kurt with this fucking thing. Everyone has lost to this fucking frog splash, man. Come on, man. Yeah.
A little weird. Just a little weird.
Cringe. Spike Dudley.
L. Bitch. Fuck you.
Arvidy comes in. Arvidy comes in and attacks Christian because Arvidy is now on SmackDown, so he has to beat up the Raw guy. All the stars are here. Johnny Nitro, Garrison Cade, Val Venus, and Lance Storm jump RVD. The SmackDown locker room empties out for the brawl. Eddie and Triple H are brawling in the ring while there's a big fight around the ring. This is a cool fucking scene here. I'm disappointed by the finish, but all this stuff I thought was fucking chaotic and fun to watch. Lawler and JR said, come on. Lawler says, come on, JR. We need to go down there and hit Cole and Taz. Which is fucking crazy. So SmackDown's whooping ass. Glass shatters. Stone Cold comes out on the ATV and he's bringing the troops. The Raw roster empties out. There's a 40-man brawl to Stone Cold's music. Austin gets off the ATV and starts beating up SmackDown.
Why?
Guys.
Why you get off the ATV? Why not drive the ATV down there like GTA or something?
He should have drove. He should have ran people over, Tony. You're right.
That would have been awesome.
So why did the Raw roster not want to come help till Stone Cold brought him out?
They don't give a fuck, man. They work tonight.
Yeah, that's true.
Chris Benoit didn't want to help Eddie or anybody until
no
Stone Cold said, hey!
Fuck, get on down here, son. Hey, get on. What are you doing? What are you doing, Spike?
That's a little crazy. Just saying.
So the show ends with a big brand brawl, which was a cool way to end the show.
Ends with a ski-woe. We're all out of time.
Definitely, yeah.